Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Oliver Sacks was a professor, and is a professor of neurology. He used to be at Columbia University, professor of neurology and psychiatry, and now he is a professor at New York University. And in his field, he had the opportunity to explore all sorts of interesting topics. In fact, some of you might remember the movie that was made of his life called Awakening. Robin Williams played the role of Professor Sacks. He also has written a number of books with interesting titles. One of the books is called The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. I haven't read it yet, but one of these days, when I no longer understand Karen, I will read the book and see what I can learn about it. Of course, that day will never come. I always understand it. He also wrote other books. Another book that he wrote was An Anthropologist on Mars. And in that particular book, he talked about a case that he had of a man by the name of Oliver who was born blind. Remember, the gospel lesson said not very many people were born blind from the very beginning. They hadn't really seen someone like that. Because you see, it's very rare to have somebody who is blind from the very beginning of his life and then is healed from that blindness when they're old. There have only been about 40 or 50 cases to date of people who were blind and then received their sight when they were old, as this young gentleman was in our scripture lesson. We don't exactly know how old he was, but we know from his parents that he was of age. And so he must have been at least old enough for them to make that kind of assertion. What Oliver Sacks discovered is what he did not expect. He expected people who would receive sight, even as adults, to be in euphoria. And to a certain extent, they were. They were excited about their new condition. They were excited about their life, especially when they could see motion, which they had never been able to see before. And when they could actually see colors, which they had never seen before. But what surprised them was not what these people were able to do, men like Oliver, but what they weren't able to do. And what they weren't able to do is see distance. They couldn't see height. They couldn't see depth. They couldn't see anything 3D. And in fact, they had such a limited perspective on life as a seeing person, because they had never yet experienced life with their eyes. And Oliver Sacks makes the statement and the assertion. And the statement and the assertion that he makes is that one has to die to being a blind man in order to be born again as a seeing person. One has to die as a blind man in order to be born again as a seeing person. What he discovered is that the blind person, even though they could now see, was still interpreting the world around him as if he couldn't see. And they had a long, long learning curve in order to really begin the process of living life as a seeing person as opposed to living life as a blind person. Now, in our story, in our gospel lesson for today, and when I use the word story, I don't mean to suggest that it isn't true, because we sometimes use the word story that way. In our gospel account, in our lesson, in our story that is related here, we find the man who is blind, who is physically blind, and he receives sight. And it's a wonderful occasion for him. He appears to be happy, and he's probably telling everyone, wouldn't you? If you had been blind from the time you were born and now could see, wouldn't you tell everybody, wow, I can see. I've never been able to see before. And wouldn't you also have a special affinity for the doctor who restored your eyesight? Can you imagine yourself being operated on before the surgery, nothing happens, after the surgery, suddenly you can see and you experience life differently, even though it may take a long period of time? Well, I think that all of us would probably really appreciate the doctor and praise him in all sorts of ways. And so here, this blind person is physically blind. A miracle occurs. Jesus takes some mud and he takes his spit and he combines the two and uses them to restore eyesight, orders him to go to the priest's alone, wash, and his eyesight is restored. That's apparently the story that we're talking about here. But in reality, there's something else going on. The focus is not on physical blindness. It's not on physical disabilities. The focus in this story, in this ninth chapter, the focus of this story is on spiritual blindness. Because we find all the way through this account, in almost all of the 41 verses, we have the Pharisees appearing again and again and again. Now what do? The Pharisees, the neighbors interview him, the Pharisees interview him, and they basically say, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such signs? You see, there were two groups here. One group started with the assumption that he was a sinner because he had actually healed somebody on the Sabbath. And if you're a sinner, then of course you can't heal. Now the illogic of that, it wasn't apparent to them, because how could they say you cannot heal on the Sabbath and say that since you're a sinner, you really didn't heal? The fact of the matter is that the others were much more accurate in their approach. They looked at this man and said, he has been healed, and since sinners cannot heal, he must be somebody who is much greater than just a sinner. And so again, the Pharisees, after they go through this first round of investigation and first round of inquiries, again, approach the man and approach the parents and approach the man. And again, we know that this man is a sinner, they say. Why don't you glorify God, they say to the man. And he answered, whether he's a sinner, I do not know. But the text is full of references to the fact that the disciples were unwilling to break out of their own way of seeing things, in quotation marks, their own way of seeing things, and allowing the facts to speak to them. They had preconceived notions about who Jesus really was, and those preconceived notions prevented them from being spiritually seeing persons. They were spiritually blind. In contrast, we find that the man himself went also through a progression. He also started off with this man, and when he was asked by the neighbors who this guy was, he said, well, it's the man called Jesus who made mud and put it on my eyes and told me to go and wash it in the salon. So the first understanding that he had of Jesus is that this was just a man. And a few moments later, when he is asked again, this time by the Pharisees, what do you say about him since he has opened your eyes? Now, he says he's a prophet. You see, there's a progression. We move from this just being a man to a man who is a prophet. And then it goes on to say that they confess Jesus, or he was, the man didn't confess Jesus right away. Before all of that happened, he actually said, you know what? This guy had to be from God. This man had to be from God. And so, sure enough, he attests to that. And then finally we find Jesus approaching him after he'd been thrown out of the synagogue, excommunicated, so to speak. We find Jesus approaching him, following him. And this time, Jesus says, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered and he said, who is he, sir, that I might believe in him? And Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you. He said, Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. You see the progression that is in the text? Let me go back just to Nicodemus for a few Sundays ago. Remember what Nicodemus had to do? He approached Jesus as a teacher, but he had to discover that approaching him as a teacher really did not do Jesus justice, and in fact, did not do himself any justice. And so he had to recognize him as Lord and Savior, not just as a teacher. We also talked about the Samaritan woman last Sunday, and then the Samaritan woman, what did she She confronted Jesus, and she was able to see who he was, and she had to see him not just as an ordinary human being. She had to see him as somebody who is greater than Jacob. And once she saw him as greater than Jacob, she could get living water, because he was the prince who brought living water, the servant who brought living water to him as he brought to us. And so today, the Pharisees have made up their minds. He's a sinner. Let's put him in a box. We can lock him up. We don't have to worry about him anymore. On the other hand, the man who received his physical sight also saw spiritually. He saw him not just as a man, which was the first way he saw him, not just as a prophet, which is the second way that he saw him, not just as a man sent from God who is without sin. He finally saw him as the Son of God, the Son of Man, the Messiah who had come to save him. You see, you and I need to go through the same kind of progression. You and I need to recognize who Jesus is. If we go just into the previous chapter, I think we can begin to get some clarity or further clarity. In the previous chapter, at the Festival of the Booths, Jesus says to the people and to the Pharisees, he says, again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And in the ninth chapter that we've been looking at, we also read in the fifth verse, I believe it is, "As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." But let's notice something. What makes the difference, what allows us to see, is not just the light of Jesus. Listen to the words. Again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." You see, yes, Jesus is the light of the world, but in order for us to avail ourselves of that light, in order for us to see by that light, we have to follow him. And only when we follow him will we be able to get rid of our spiritual blindness. Now, is it easy to follow him? Sometimes. Other times it isn't. Remember Oliver Sacks, who said in order for one has to die to being a blind person in order to be born again as a seeing person. They talked about all the difficulties that a person has when they suddenly receive sight. If you and I really follow Jesus, the path will at times be difficult. It will require a complete reorientation of our lives. It will require us no longer to focus on ourselves as the center of all activity, as the center of the world. Leave that behind, to die, in terms of Nicodemus, to be born again as a seeing person, which may take some time, as a seeing person, but it's a gift that is made possible through amazing grace. And now, that's what we're going to sing, right? So please rise with me if you would, and let's sing Amazing Grace, and listen to the words. Amazing grace, and then it goes on. I once was lost, and now I'm found. I was blind.